Eternal life begins the day I come into Christ. The blessings of God begins to flow toward me, and the favor of God is upon me from the day that I set, turned my face to Him and believed in Him as my Lord and Savior, Jesus.
When peace like a river attended my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my Lord, Thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious time. My sin not in part, but the whole is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul.
Blessings of redemption that has come to us in and through Christ is like that. They are in Christ Jesus. It's like a bank deposit, except this bank is very good. It's not going anywhere. Banks fail, but this bank never fails. Jesus never fails. So it is all in Christ. All the blessings are deposited in Christ for you and I. Deposited for us so that we can access it, we can get it. So even though I may not have even one little blessing out of it right now, every blessing is mine. I have a claim to it. I have a legal claim to it. It is mine in and through redemption. Right? So it is possible that you don't see it in your account. You don't see it in your hand. You don't see you having all of those things in hand and using it. But still, it's still in the hoping stage. You're hoping. You're hoping for these things. But you can have confirmation. Do you have confirmation that it's yours? Are you sure? Do you have the assurance that it's yours? Yeah, because they sent the notice. 100 crores is mine, right? The document said it. It's a legal document. Huh? Everything says that that money is mine, right? So I have the assurance, I have the confirmation. Do you have the title deed for it? Yeah. The papers say that it's mine. See what I'm saying? Everything says that it's mine. Do I have it? Yeah, it's in the bank. Do I have it now? Can I? One of you came and said, can you give me just 1 crore? I can't, because it's not right here yet. I'm still hoping for it, hoping to receive it. But I have the confirmation, assurance, the title deed that it belongs to me. That's what faith is. Just like you know for sure that it's yours. You know that the blessings of Calvary are yours. Blessings for spirit, soul, and body and every area of your life is yours in and through Jesus Christ. All right? And then, see, the translation continues. Amplified is really amplified. So little words, they just make it big, you know. They amplify it. So he says, now faith is the assurance, brackets, confirmation, title deed of the things we hope for. Faith being the proof of things that we do not see. Now listen to this. This is the most important part. And the conviction of their reality. What is faith? Not only assurance, proof, and confirmation and all that. It is a conviction of their reality. That means they really do exist. The things that I'm hoping for, they are really mine. And in my heart, I have an unshakable conviction that they are mine. They are really mine. Conviction of their reality. And then, this is good about Amplified. They amplify it, what it means, in brackets. After conviction of their reality, he says, faith, perceiving as real fact what is not revealed to the senses. That's what is meant by conviction of their reality. Faith, perceiving as real fact what is not revealed to the senses. That means I don't have it in hand. I can't touch it, feel it, use it right now. But faith perceives it as a reality, even though it cannot access it through the senses. Faith perceives it as a reality. Now, so faith is this assurance, confirmation, this title deed, this proof, this conviction, unshakable conviction that these things are mine. How many of you understand what I'm talking about? That these things are mine. Now let me ask you, how do you arrive at that conviction or that assurance or that confirmation? How do you arrive at that stage where you say, I know it's mine. I am assured. I have a confirmation. I have the proof. I have the conviction, unshakable conviction that it's mine. Everybody says, no, you don't have anything. But you have conviction, you say. You have assurance, you say. How can you say that? How did you arrive at, how does a believer arrive at such an assurance in their heart, conviction in their hearts, confirmation in their hearts about the things that are theirs in and through Jesus Christ? How do we arrive at that? See, this is where, so simple. You arrived at it by the word of God. That's why it says, faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word. How did I arrive at it? See, there was a time that I didn't know anything about it. In fact, in the days when I was growing up, they told me everything I'll get when I get to heaven. So according to them, the best thing is I die, you know. I can't get anything right now here. And I didn't want to die because I didn't even start living yet. So they preached so wonderfully about heaven. They said, when you get to heaven, you'll walk on streets of gold and there's mansion there. And I'll be sitting there saying, not now, brother. I'm not going there now. Keep that mansion waiting. I am in no hurry to get the mansion now. I'm in no hurry to walk on streets of gold now. But why don't you just throw me just a couple of pieces of it, the gold? They told us, you can get nothing here. You got to die to get there. So that's why Christian life became miserable, you know. So when you prayed, now listen to this. When you prayed, you went to pray and ask God, who has kept everything for the future. You're trying to now convince him. Instead of you getting convinced that it's yours, our prayer in those days was trying to convince God that he must part with some of it at least now and give it now, because I need it now to pay my rent, to pay my fees, for my expenses. I need a little money now. And he's saying, come over here, I got mansion. He said, little bit now, sir. Mansion later. Just a little foretaste. How about giving a little mansion here? Something like a 3-4-5 bedroom mansion with a couple of car garage. Let the big mansion wait, I'll come and get it. But how about a few things here? So when we prayed for anything, it was like you are up against a wall. You know, you're up against this God. He won't give. And you are up against him trying to get from him. This God that doesn't want to give. He has kept everything in heaven. Doesn't want to send everything, anything to this earth, because this earth is a cursed place. He keeps everything there. And you're trying very hard to get everything from him. So prayer, you enter into prayer not convinced that it's yours now. You enter into prayer hoping that he will somehow part with it now. That you can convince him. Hello. So, we had many approaches to prayer, which still continues now. One approach is, cry and beg. Maybe he will see your tears and see you begging and have a little mercy and just chip off some of that gold on that street. And here, have a little bit. You know. So they told us, begging him, crying. And if begging and crying didn't work, then we went on fasting. Now, this is the fasting I'm against. Now, some people think I'm against fasting, period, you know. Not so. This is the fasting I'm against. The fasting that's trying to convince him to give it. I fast to convince myself. I fast so that I can set aside the time that I spend for eating and then sleeping. Usually that's what happens after you eat, right? You can't even think because we eat so, some of the food is so good, you know. Like this afternoon, that's what's going to happen. I can tell you that. I'm a good prophet, you know. You're going to eat and then you're going to sleep, you know. Are you going to eat and then study the Bible seriously? No. Eating leads to sleeping. So that is why I fast. Why I fast? Because I don't want to sleep. I want to spend that time to learn more. I want to be convinced. I need assurance. I need this confirmation. God has done so much for me, kept so much for me in Christ. I hardly know anything at all about it. I know very little about it. I need to explore this. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has ever comprehended the wonderful things that God has prepared for them that love him. So I need to get into this. I need time. I need time. So sometimes even the time that I eat is needed more for the sake of being awake. You know, if I don't eat, I can stay awake better. So I can concentrate on that kind of fasting is okay, where you're trying to convince yourself of the things that are available. But most of the Christian fasting all over the world is about trying to convince this God who never gets convinced. We think, what's wrong with God? You know, we think if we fasted long enough, somebody told me, try 3 days. If it doesn't work, go 7 days. That doesn't work, go 21 days. I saw one fellow write in a magazine, said, I'm fasting for 21 days. This is the 16th day, only 5 more days left. Send in your prayer requests immediately. I was going to write to him and ask him, brother, in 5 days, is heaven going to be closed? Is God going on vacation? Is he not going to answer any more prayer hereafter? What are you talking about, you know? See, this is the approach I don't like, you see. This is not right. And I'm not ashamed to say that. It is not right at all. And I followed that method also. As a follower of that method, I tell you. I've tried it. It doesn't work. Only later on I found out God says, I am God. Don't try to change me. I change not, he said. So I concluded at one point in my life, no use trying to change God and convince him about anything. I better get convinced about what he's trying to say. Then I went to the Bible and I got convinced that it's not in heaven. It is here and now it begins. Eternal life begins the day I come into Christ. The blessings of God begins to flow toward me. And the favor of God is upon me from the day that I turned my face to him and believed in him as my Lord and Savior, Jesus. That is a revelation. After that is a big journey of finding out what all is there. Some people say, this is a big book, brother. I say, well, you bet, you know, there's a lot that has been kept for us. You know, if your will is this long, written by somebody who owns the heaven and earth, you won't mind reading that will. You won't complain about, what a big book, brother. He should have given us something in 5 pages, you know, that we can read in 5 minutes. You know. No, you can't read this in 5 minutes. You cannot understand it in 5 months. I can't even preach it in my whole lifetime. If I was born 100 times and lived 100 years each time, it will not be enough to preach it. That's how much is kept for us. So that is why we listen to it. That's why we come to church and listen to a preacher preach about it. Because Christian preaching is about what God has prepared for us. Right? What God has prepared for us. So, when you go in prayer, you better be convinced that these things are yours. You better be convinced that by the cross of Calvary and through what Jesus has done, these things have been credited to your account. It has come in, credited to your account, and you have access to it. And faith gives you access to it. If you go, see the devil, see, just like we are brokers, lawyers, accountants, and all these people, you know, you have to deal with first the government, everybody, you know, they all get their share. Then only you get a little bit at the end, you know, if somebody left you 100 crore. And then there will be some rogues that get in the middle that want to rip you off of whatever you have coming, you know. So you got to watch out. When you have 100 crores, you got to have both eyes open all the time. See that nobody takes anything from you, you know. But with the blessings of God, there is one big rogue, the devil. He doesn't want you to get anything. He doesn't want you to walk away with any of the blessings of God. He wants to rip you off completely and leave you high and dry, empty, with nothing. But I tell you, when you stand by faith and when you go and take access by faith, even the devil himself cannot stop you. Nothing can stop you from receiving what God has prepared for you. Amen? Amen? So, what does it mean to say, whatever you pray for and ask for, believe that you receive them? This is what it means. Believe that you receive means, I know it's there. In Christ, it's there. It's all redemptive blessings. It's all stored up in Christ for me. I believe that I've received it. I believe that I am the owner of it. I believe that I have proper documents for it. I believe that I have proof of it. I believe and I have confirmation and I have the conviction that it's mine. I can believe that I receive it. I received it. Amen? Now you understand the meaning? I've been just trying to explain what it means to say, believe that you have received it. So I believe that I receive it. Because it's all in Christ. It's all done for me, kept for me, ready for me. It's all legally mine. I believe that I received it. Then only I have it. Sure, it takes some time to get it, you know, on my hand where I can have a use of it. But I believe I received it. If I don't believe I received it, I can't have it. Can you imagine a guy saying, well, I don't believe somebody left 100 crore for me. Then he can't have it because he won't sign any papers. He won't go anywhere. He won't do the proper procedures. He won't do nothing. He cannot have it. You got to believe that you received it. Then only you can have it. Right? So, now we know what verse 24 means. Whatever things you pray and ask for, believe that you have received it. We know what that means. That one single line is what I've been explaining all this time. Believe that you have received it and you shall have it. We know what it means. And we know how we can believe that we received it. We believe that we received it because we came to the Word of God. It helped us to believe. The Word of God is the thing that gave us that assurance, that confirmation, that surety The word of God is the thing that gave us that conviction which is called faith. Faith cometh by hearing. So what is believing? Believing is basically simply trusting someone's word, which all of us do all the time. We trust someone's word. Suppose you heard a rumor, bad rumor. Most people, even though they have not checked it out, it looks suspicious, it doesn't look like real, but you know, a lot of people can just simply hear it and tell it's not real. But there are some people that have no problem in believing rumors like that. They will immediately believe it. Is that so? And then the next minute they'll pick up the phone and you should hear them talk. They will talk as if they are eyewitness. I am telling you, this is the actuality. This is the truth. This is what it is. I know it. I know. How do you know it? Some stupid person told you something. You don't even know whether this person has proper information or not. But you believe it. See, we don't have any problem believing and trusting in someone's word. We have only problem with God's word. That's what I'm pointing out. Our problem is only with what God says. We have no problem with what anybody says. We are ready to believe anybody. When you went and got your job, they told you they'll pay you 50,000 rupees a month, this and this benefit and so on, travel expenses and medical expenses and all of that. And you were all smiles and you shook hands and said, thank you, I'm joining tomorrow. And why didn't you ask the guy, give me your accounts, I want to check to see if you can pay me 50,000 a month. Have you got the money? Where is your auditor's accounts? Give me your auditor's phone number. I'll verify. See if they got the money to pay me. You never ask that. You believe that man's words. You take that employment order. You neatly bring it. Keep it so safely. Create a file. You know. It's an important document. Now you're sure you got a job, you're sure what your salary is going to be, sure what your benefit's going to be, you're sure of everything. You don't even know if that guy is going to flee from the country tomorrow, take all the money and run away after you work for one whole month. Hello. How come you believe the guy? See, that is basically faith. Amounts to that. It's trusting in someone's word. When the person is good, then the word is good. When you know a good person, you can trust his word because that person is good, his word is good. Same here, you know, with God. He's a good God. Therefore, his word is good. He keeps his word at the... No matter what loss he incurs because of that. At the cost of anything, he keeps his word. He has exalted his word even above his name and fame and everything. His word is most important to him. That's what the Bible says.
Thanks be to God, who always causes us triumph in his name. Thanks be to God, who always causes us to win. Yeah. Thanks be to God, who always causes us. In his name, thanks be to God, thanks be to God. We have overcome, hallelujah, hallelujah. We have overcome by the power of your name. Jesus, you're the one, hallelujah, hallelujah. One who made a way for us. Triumph in his name. Oh, whoa, oh, whoa, oh, whoa. Thanks be to God, who always causes us to triumph in his name. Thanks be to God, who always causes us to win. Yeah. Thanks be to God, who always causes us to triumph in his name. Thanks.
clap our hands and say,
thanks be to God, we have overcome. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We have overcome by the power of your name. Jesus, you're the one.
Everything will be alright, alright.
We got the victory. Everything will be alright.
We're on the winning side.
We got the victory. Everything will be alright, alright.
We got the victory. Everything will be alright.
We're on the winning side.
One more time.
We got the victory. Everything will be alright. Alright,
we got the victory. Everything will be alright.
'Cause we're on the winning side. We're on the winning side.
We have overcome.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
We have overcome by the power of your name.
Jesus, you're the one.